Allahu Akbar.
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. As-salatu as-salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd, a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahi r-Rahman ar-Rahim. I would like to welcome you all to ICNA Dawah Conference 2020, Islam, the Solution in Times of Confusion. Inshallah, we have, I will be your host for the session titled The Golden Ticket, and we have an amazing lineup of speakers. So, inshallah, with that being said, I would like to introduce our first speaker. Our first speaker is Imam Khalid Griggs, and he will be speaking on the topic of locked in, why should I care? Just a brief intro. Imam Khalid is the Imam at the Community Mosque of Winston-Salem. He's an associate chaplain, also the vice president of Islamic Circle of North America, a member of Central Shura, board chairman for ICNA's Council of Social Justice. Alhamdulillah, he's a human rights activist, prison reform activist, lecturer, author, and someone that I look up to who's always stood tall against injustice, oppression, and discrimination. So without further ado, Imam Khalid, please take over.
Thank you so much for that very generous introduction. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Brothers and sisters, in the time that I have allotted, I want to address the topic of locked in, why should we care? And the topic addresses those Muslims and others who are incarcerated in the penal systems across the United States. And I want to point out at the very beginning that we do not know or do not have the exact number of Muslims who are trapped into this prison industrial complex, primarily because there are no figures of those who actually come into the system and then embrace Islam after they have been incarcerated. And then there are other Muslims who come into the prison system and who do not self-identify. But what we do know is that about one out of every 10 inmates in federal, state, and local jails, federal, state prisons, we find that one out of every 10 inmates has declared themselves or identified as being a Muslim. And even though Muslims are just 0.6% over 18 years old in the Muslim population, this is an extremely high number. And what we're talking about the number of incarcerated people in this country being at least 2.4 million people, the largest incarcerated population in the world. This is not by percentage. This is my actual number of people in the population. And so this is a very horrifying number when we look at it. And what we have to understand too, with the prison system, the penal system in this country that is part of a larger complex that's identified as the prison industrial complex, this is one of the most horrendous systems of incarceration, of actually convicting people, the whole process of being arrested and put into jail, go to court, put in jail, be under supervision for maybe a decade after getting out, and never fully being free after having served time. And so we have to look at this system not just as a place where people who have committed crimes are warehoused, but we have to look at the system as part of a system that, as Muslims, we need to be involved and try to address the system. Let me just give just a couple of other quick comments about the system, and then I'll get right into the specifics of this particular topic. In the United States, as we all know, the 13th Amendment to the United States Constitution abolishes slavery in all of the territories and all of the states within the United States. But in that 13th Amendment, there's a kind of a loophole. And this loophole states that there can be no enslaved people in this country unless they have committed a crime. And when we look at the prisons today, they are the closest thing that we have as for a modern day slavery that is legal, just like chattel slavery was legal for about 350 years in the colonies and in the United States. And now we have this system that takes away the rights, forces labor, separates families, and does all of the things, for the most part, even beating and torturing, like we found in the Chicago city prison, where it was unveiled there, revealed how in that prison in Chicago, in the city, it was being used like a black site, a rendition site, where people would be taken off the street, and then no one would know where they are, their families, and no one would know where they are. Now, if we look at why we as Muslims should be concerned about this particular issue, we have to first look at the guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us in the Quran. In the interest of time, I'll just sort of glean across a couple of ayahs and a couple of hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the incentive, a divine incentive to free the captive, to spend our monies, our time, our efforts in trying to free those who have been captured, those who have been locked down. And this incentive is something that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam addresses. And if you bear with me just for a moment, and I'll read this hadith in English. And it's reported that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that no man forsakes a Muslim when his rights are being violated or his honor is being belittled, except that Allah will forsake him at a place in which he would love to have his help, Allah's help. And no man helps a Muslim at a time when his honor is being belittled or his rights violated, except that Allah will help him at a place in which he loves to have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help. And of course, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is making reference to Yawm al-Qiyamah, that on the day of judgment, that those of us who ignore the rights, that we ignore the rights of other Muslims where their rights have been taken away from them, or they have been dishonored, they have somehow lost their dignity within this system of captivity, that if we hope to have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love and assistance on Qiyamah, then we must do something to try to help restore those rights and help to restore the honor and dignity. And then the opposite, once we help in trying to restore the rights of believers, once we help in trying to free the captives, to help them in their time of need, that on Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us his help, will give us his help at a place where we would most want his help. And this is at the time of judgment. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam quickly also said that we should feed the hungry, that we should visit the sick, and that we should free the prisoners. Brothers and sisters, the responsibility that you and I have to each and every incarcerated Muslim in this country, and I'll take it even a step further and say that the responsibility and duty that we have as free and independent human beings, the responsibility that we have to not just know about the existence of so many Muslims who are incarcerated in penal institutions across this country, that it's not enough for me and others to just talk about what's going on in these places of so often people are caged like animals in a cage. You know, recently there were scenes on the U.S. border, the most southern border, where refugees and others trying to come into this country, that children were snatched from their mother's breasts, literally, and other older children were placed inside cages. Well, what is going on in the prisons and jails, mostly in the prisons across this country, are very similar to the kind of caging that has been and is going on our southernmost border with the country of Mexico. I want to share just a quick anecdote with you. A number of years ago, and this is maybe probably 30 years ago, when I first started working, it was more than that, started working in penal institutions, teaching classes and trying to help deliver other kind of services to Muslims who were incarcerated. The first time I went to this prison in Maryland, the state of Maryland, called Hagerstown, it was in Hagerstown, Maryland. And in order to try to discourage me and other Muslims from coming in to try to assist the population, rather than bring me through the area that one would normally go to when there were outside volunteers coming into the institution, the guards actually, the correctional officers actually took me the long way. And going through the long way, they took me through the area where it looked like about four levels of nothing short of cages were stacked on top of each other. These were actually supposed to be prison cells, but they looked like cages. And they took me through this very slowly. And as going through it, the men were just hollering obscenities and other kinds of things. And I was told later that this was a way to discourage me from coming from the outside to try to assist the Muslims who were there. I'm sure that this is not a story that's unique to me as a volunteer, having gone into institutions for over 40 years, that this is a common practice. So before I end, I want to talk about some of the specific things that we should be aware of and how we could address the kind of frustration that outside volunteers would have in traveling long distances to maybe conduct a class or visit certain brothers and sisters who are incarcerated, and then only to be turned around at the gate and not allowed to go into the institution that you have made the sacrifices to try to go into. I think it's very important too for me to point out that the attitude that we should have about Muslims and others who are incarcerated. Sometimes persons like myself, we need a reality check. We need to check our attitudes that we may come from the outside and bring. And that attitude in particular is the attitude that if a person is incarcerated, then they must have done something wrong. This is a very incorrect, statistically, it's an incorrect attitude for us to harbor. And it is reflected, if we don't rid ourselves of this, in our interaction with those who are incarcerated. Because of the works of very dedicated staff people in groups like the Innocence Project and other groups, like the Center on Wrongful Convictions, there and others, we have statistics. We have people who are literally working with those who have been falsely in prison, many of them for 20 or 30 years or more, that they have just been almost randomly picked up. And due to prosecutorial misconduct, due to police misconduct, due to the kind of insensitivity of judges, these people have been warehoused across this country in these penal institutions. As a matter of fact, there have been, on average, since about 2014, an average of three individuals who have been freed and exonerated, who have served very lengthy sentences, and some maybe as little as 2 or 3 years, but most of them have been very lengthy sentences. There have been over 2,000 people who have been exonerated and freed because they have been falsely incarcerated. So, in the interest of time, I would just point out that it was shocking for me to discover, reading some of these statistics, that 33% of people who have even been on death row or given life sentences without parole, that 33% of this population of incarcerated brothers and sisters, just the total population, have been convicted of murder and manslaughter of this exoneree population. And the rest were committed for what would be considered as non-violent crimes. So, in closing, we are mandated by Allah. We are mandated by the instructions of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to do what we can do to free our incarcerated brothers and sisters and help meet their needs. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. Jazakallahu khairan, Imam Khalid Griggs. Those were some very astounding facts and numbers, and inshallah, may Allah allow us to help our brothers and sisters who are incarcerated in this prison system. So with that, just wanted to point out another brilliant effort that ICNA Gain Peace has been doing in putting up billboards, mailing postcards, running social media campaigns on the topic of justice and racism. Alhamdulillah, we've had billboards up in cities like Bay Area, Sacramento, Houston, all over the nation. And, with the message that really pertains to the time and needs of this current society and the social issues. So I would really encourage everyone to take some time and donate financially and your time in terms of volunteering. So with that, I will pass this on to the next moderator for the next session. Jazakallahu khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.